It was a congregational song. And I just need a little reverb and put my guitar in. Okay, you can all rise. Please, you may stand. Word of God speak. Here we go. I'm finding myself at long lost words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. Last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God speak. I'm finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice. Word of God speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God speak. Would you pour down my rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Finding myself at long lost for words, and the funny thing is, it's okay. Okay, you may be seated. I'm going to do another song. It's called Invisible Hero, and I don't know what page it's on. Cheyenne will tell you in our songbooks. Invisible Hero. I wrote this song like 20-something years ago now. 25 years ago. Okay, here we go. We fight a war against the forces of darkness, and not against flesh and blood. We're standing firm against the schemes of the devil, and taking up our shield of faith, yeah. I wanna be an invisible hero. I wanna be his faithful soldier. Friend, to put on our armor and gird our loins with the truth. It's time to brandish the sword of the spirit. These are our weapons of war, yeah. I wanna be an invisible hero. I wanna be his faithful soldier. I wanna be an invisible hero. I wanna be fear, for your soul's a battleground. Oh yeah. I wanna be an invisible hero. I wanna be this faithful soldier. I wanna be an invisible hero. I wanna be this faithful soldier. We fight a war against the forces of darkness, and not a cleansed flesh and blood. We're standing firm against the schemes of the devil, and taking up our shield of faith, yeah. I wanna be an invisible hero. I wanna be his faithful soldier. Called Don't Love the World. It's a new song. It's in our, I don't know where the lyrics for the new songs are. I saw there was a notebooks over there. I think. Let's see if they're, yeah, they're over here, Cheyenne. Can you pass these out to everybody? This is a fairly new song. It's on the new collection of songs. It's on the website. It's on our YouTube page, too. It's got a weird tuning, so. Of course, these songs are fitting to what we're going to be talking about today.
Things of the world, anyone else in the world.
things of the world, if anyone loves the world, then the love of the Father is not in him. Don't love the world. Don't love the world. Don't love the world. Okay. That song is, when it says the world there, remember that's taken off of 1 John 2:15 through 17, where it says, it means the world there means the world system of Satan. Remember, the whole world is deceived by Satan, and that's why those opening lines are referring to that. So a lot, all these songs are based on scripture, so I try to use the music as a teaching aid as well. So that's what you're supposed to do in church, not to, just to entertain people. In fact, you should never entertain people. You're there to instruct people as a pastor, whether it's through music or your own spoken words. So, okay, we're going to, we were here last Sunday. We just weren't here in our weekday classes this week. But we're going to be in 1 Thessalonians 2:18 here this evening. We're going to be talking about Satan hindering Paul and Silvanus from returning to see the Thessalonian Christian community. So that's why those two songs that I just sang for you are related to dealing with Satan and his kingdom. So we should be at 1 Thessalonians 2:13. Let's start there. 1 Thessalonians 2:13. And I just want a few announcements before we get underway and take our have our opening prayer. Remember, a lot of these announcements are for people who are unfamiliar with our ministry. We have all kinds of new people hitting our website. And also YouTube, our YouTube page. We're also getting some people from Academia EDU that are hitting our website. I was looking at some of the hits the other day, and I was like some of the hits like on 1 John and Obadiah that we did, like they've just gone crazy, and a lot of the other classes too. So it's encouraging. So there are people listening in, watching and stuff. So for them, we're just a house church. We have a few families here in Iowa. We're in Marion, Iowa. We live in teach out of my friend's house, him and his wife, Titus and Jody Thompson, and we meet here three times a week. We teach Tuesday and Thursday evenings from 7 to 8 p.m. We have a prayer meeting for our internet people to join us through the website on Thursday evenings after class. Sunday mornings, it's usually 9 to about 10:15. When we do the Lord's Supper, which is the first Sunday of each month, it runs around close to 10:30, sometimes 20 past, depends on what's going on. But we're, again, expository type ministry. That means all of our classes are different from each other. Every sermon is different. In other words, we go through the different books of the Bible, you know, verse by verse, paragraph by paragraph, book by book. We alternate between Old Testament, New Testament. In between books, we do different subjects that are taught in the Bible, different doctrines like justification by faith, the Trinity, the rapture, the remnant of Israel we just finished off, salvation, sanctification. We've done a whole slew of stuff, subjects. All of our classes are recorded, video and audio. We don't delete any of our classes to make room in our website because of the great work of Titus, who designs that website, especially designed for our needs. And you'll never find a website designed like it in the world, really. And so because of his hard work, we don't have to delete any of our classes. So video and audio, we have all my classes I've done since I've been in Iowa, which is now be 18 years this August, I believe. I was here 2001 August. So we have over 1,000, I don't know how many articles now, but it's well over 1,000 written articles that are on our website. Many of these articles you can see on a site called Academia EDU, which is a scholar site, a site where a lot of scholars go to. So there are people hitting that there, our stuff. But also we have our video and audio classes. We have them on Sound Faith as well, which is part of the Logos Bible program. So like if some pastor or some Christian is learning, you know, 1 John 2:15 and studying that and they're going to teach on it, well, they'll see our audio and video classes of those passages. So it's pretty cool. So when I go through it, it's kind of funny. I go, oh, there we are. You know, it's pretty funny. And so that's a cool program. Logos is the Bible program I use. So we also, we're a grace ministry. We don't charge for our teaching. You go to some websites and you have to $9.99 or $20 to download some guy's
video or audio or written article or something like that. We don't do any of that. It doesn't mean it's for free. I mean, because you're to reciprocate Galatians 6:6. Those who taught the word of God share all good things with those who teach him. The worker's worthy of his wages, Jesus taught, and his disciples in Matthew 10 and Luke 10. And of course, those who work hard at preaching and teaching are worthy of double honor. We'll study that in 1 Thessalonians 5:11-12. And so I just, we just make it available free charge. And the reason why I do that, there's an article on our website that identifies that reason, and there's many reasons, but one reason is if you're a person like many people from Pakistan or India or Africa, they come and hit our website and they don't have the money to word of God. They can't afford $20 or whatever. Well, they can download it from our site free of charge. So money is not an obstacle in getting the word of God in this ministry. So that means I have to have faith that God will bring in the money so that I can make a living in doing this. And I've been fortunate since I've been out here. I've been able to do this full time. So hopefully that will continue and people will continue to support the ministry. And so that's it for the one more announcement. We, as was the case this past week, we will not have any weekday classes. We will not have any weekday classes this week, but we will have our Sunday class coming up. And then our weekday classes will resume on Tuesday, May 7th. Now, there's also coming up, I'm going to be going back east in May. I'll be going back east May 27th to June 7th. So May 27th to June 7th, I will be out of town. I'll be in Massachusetts. As most of you know, my mother's has dementia, and I try to go back there the last several years to help my father out and her out and spend time with them. And so keep that in prayer. So there will be no classes during that period of time. We will we'll start back when I return. Will be the first class that will be June 9th. Sunday, June 9th is when we'll resume classes. So mark those in your calendar, and I'll be continuing to repeat that announcement in the next couple of weeks as we lead up to that 2 week break. So let's take a moment of silent prayer. As is our custom, we take a moment of silent prayer to examine ourselves, to see if we're to determine if we need to confess our sins, to be restored to fellowship with God. Remember, any mental, verbal, or overt act of sin that we commit, it will knock us out of fellowship. In order to be filled with the Spirit, meaning our thoughts are governed by the Holy Spirit, we must confess our sins, and then that restores us to fellowship with God. We maintain that fellowship by obeying what the Holy Spirit teaches us in the scripture. And remember, I'll give you an example of that. Let's say you are bitter towards somebody, your wife or your husband, for whatever reason. Well, you're out of fellowship for bitterness. In fact, the Bible tells the men, and was it 1 Peter 3:1-7 and other places in Paul's writing, you're not to be embittered toward your wives. That's something men have to watch out for. Not that women can't, but men are more susceptible to it. So when you, instead of being bitter toward her and being, if you do that, you confess the sin of being bitter toward her, and then you do what God says, what it says. Well, you're to be patient and tolerant of your wife as God in Christ is with you. You've been forgiven your sins. He puts up with you. Well, you could put up with your wife if God has put up with you and he's forgiven you. And that goes vice versa for the ladies in regards to their husband. So that's an example of that. So we confess the sin, it restores us to fellowship, but we have to stay in fellowship by obeying what God says. And so if we go right back to being bitter toward somebody, then we're still sinning. So we're not really staying in fellowship. We're going in and out. So we need to follow the confession of sin, follow it up with obedience to what the Word of God says. So the Word of God says, instead of being bitter, to be forgiving, and as God in Christ is forgiving you. So with that in mind, with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for another day that you've given to us to gather together as members of the royal family of God, the body of Christ, the future bride of Christ, to worship you, your Son, Jesus Christ, through the power of the Spirit, to worship you through learning and obeying your almighty word. We thank you for everyone that is here this morning in the Thompson home, the McMurrays, the Tyson Jody Thompson and the kids and their and everybody who is following, listening right now, live through the website or later date through the recordings on the website. We thank you for each and every one of them. We thank you for Tyson Jody Thompson's hospitality and opening up their home to us 3 days a week. We also thank you for the people you've raised that are praying for this ministry, that are supporting this ministry, attending classes and serving. And we pray that if you see fit, you would raise up more individuals that would be good stewards with the time, talent, and treasure and truth, and would be a part of this ministry and learning and obeying your word and serving in it. And we also thank you for Titus's work with the sound and the recordings here this morning. We pray that you would help him in that area. We pray that no problems in that area. And we also pray, we thank you for his service, the technology, and the people taking advantage of the technology. We also pray that you would help, by the power of the Spirit, everyone in the audience to learn and understand and apply what they're being taught here this morning. Help them all to concentrate. I pray that the Holy Spirit would work mightily and powerfully through them in speaking to each individual and all of us as a corporate unit. I also pray that you would work mightily and powerfully through me. Help me be your servant and your instrument to bring forth your full counsel to your people. Help me to communicate the contents of 1 Thessalonians 2:18 with accuracy and clarity and reverence and respect so that your people could receive the necessary spiritual nourishment. And so we pray, Father, that as a result, all of us in this ministry will continue to grow in the grace and knowledge of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. So it is in his name we pray. Amen. All right, you should be at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 13. What I want to do is I'm going to read 1 Thessalonians 2:13, and I'm going to read all the way into verse 19. So verses 13 through 19, I'm going to read from the NET Bible. So our verse again is 1 Thessalonians 2:18. So I want to look at verse 18 in its context. That's why I'm doing this. So 1 Thessalonians 2:13 says, "And so we too constantly thank God that when you received God's message that you heard from us, you accepted it not as a human message, but as it truly is, God's message, which is at work among you who believe. For you became imitators, brothers and sisters, of God's churches in Christ Jesus that are in Judea, because you too suffered the same things from your own countrymen as they in fact did from the Jews, who killed both the Lord Jesus and the prophets and persecuted us severely. They're displeasing to God and are opposed to all people, because they hindered us from speaking to the Gentiles so that they may be saved. Thus they constantly fill up their measure of sins, but wrath has come upon them completely. But when we were separated from you, brothers and sisters, for a short time, in presence, not in affection, we became all the more fervent in our great desire to see you in person, for we wanted to come to you. I, Paul, in fact, tried again and again, but Satan thwarted us. For who is our hope or joy or crown to boast of before our Lord Jesus at his coming? Is it not, of course, you? For you are our glory and joy." So we're going to be looking at verse 18, which references Satan here as hindering Paul and Silvanus' attempts, more than one attempt, to come back to Thessalonica to minister to the Thessalonians and have fellowship with them. Now, 1 Thessalonians 2:18 contains two assertions, as we can see. The first states that Paul and Silvanus wanted to enter into the presence of each member of the Thessalonian Christian community, but Satan hindered them from doing so. The second is what we call an emphatic parenthetical remark. That's why it's in parentheses. It's embedded into the first assertion. And Paul emphatically asserts with it that independently of Silvanus, Paul himself attempted to visit the Thessalonians on more than one occasion. Now, this parenthetical remark that you see in parentheses in the NET Bible reveals that Paul is the author of 1 Thessalonians and not Silvanus and Timothy. Now, the first assertion in 1 Thessalonians 2:18, as I pointed out, states that Paul and Silas wanted to enter into the presence of the Thessalonians, but they were hindered by Satan. And then he presents the reason for this previous state, first assertion is actually presenting the reason for the previous statement in verse 17. So when he says in your NET Bible, "For we wanted to come to you, but Satan thwarted us," and we cut out the parenthesis, "For we wanted to come to you, Thessalonians, but Satan thwarted us." Well, that statement is actually presenting the reason for the previous statement in verse 17, which, as we just read, asserts that when Paul and Silvanus were orphaned from the Thessalonians for a short period of time, and presence only, never in heart, they made every effort with great desire to see them. Because if you recall, look at verse 17, "But when we were separated from you," remember when we studied this? The word that's translated, "we were separated," in your NET Bible, in many translations, they translate it orphaned. And the idea is that Paul and Silvanus were orphaned from the Thessalonians. Like parents could be, and the word orphan was used not only of parents with separation from their children, but children from their parents. So it's not used the way we use it in the first century. It was used in of parents with regards to their children in the first century. So Paul and Silvanus felt like they were orphaned from the Thessalonian Christian community. So that's what he means by we were separated. So verse 18, when it says, "For we wanted to come to you, but Satan thwarted us," that's presenting the reason for the statement there that we just read in verse 17. Now, here in verse 18, Satan is identified as the reason why they had never returned to Thessalonica. Satan hindered these two men from visiting the Thessalonians in the sense that he resisted and interfered with their attempts to do so. So Satan, this tells us that Satan is a person. He's an angel, we know from other scriptures, as we'll see here this morning. He is a fallen angel. He was actually the anointed cherub who was a prophet, priest, and king back in eternity past, before mankind was created. He became the adversary of God, Ezekiel 28, as we'll see in 11 through 19, and as Isaiah 14, 12 through 14, mentioned the fact that he basically attempted a coup d'etat. He basically wants to be like God, and he wanted the angels to worship him, and he wanted to be a rival to God. And this is why sin came into the universe. It came in first with the angels. It says in Job that God finds fault with his angels. So it's not a lot is said about the angels in regards to the fall, but we know that's the case. In fact, we know that all the angels were condemned before God. How do we know that? That passage I mentioned in Job, but also if you read Revelation 5, it says, when it comes to the fact, John was weeping over the fact that nobody was able to open the seven sealed scroll in Revelation 5, which is the title deed to earth. But the angel came up to him and said, "Stop your weeping. The Lamb, Jesus Christ, is able to open the seven sealed scroll. He's the only one in heaven and earth and under the earth and is able to and worthy to open the seven sealed scroll." Worthy. That means the angels, who there are angels that are incarcerated underneath the earth in Tartarus, and then there's also angels that have access, the angels have access, both elect and fallen, have access to God's throne, and they have their access to the stellar universe. And so they are, none of them were worthy, not Michael, not Gabriel, none of them. So that tells you that there was a fall. The angels, two-thirds, we know from Revelation chapter 12, two-thirds went with God, and another third of the angels, the other third of the angels went with Satan and his rebellion. Interestingly enough, if you look at the as we'll see in Ezekiel, the ephod that a priest would have in Israel, when we studied in Exodus, there was 12 precious stones on the ephod, and that on the high priest wore that, and each of those precious stones represented one of the tribes of Israel. Well, Satan had one, and he said he was adorned with precious stones, and he mentions nine of them. Well, that would be the nine tribes of angels. A third went with Satan, and two-thirds went with God. So Satan was a priest, and in eternity past, he was the anointed cherub, and so he rebelled against God. He was close access to God, and he was the wisest creature ever to come from the hand of God, and he was the most attractive person. If you saw Satan today, you would be absolutely blown away by Satan. You'd be impressed by him. I'll tell you a funny story one time. When I first came to Iowa and I was teaching at the other place, I remember this early on, and I mentioned, I used to, if you saw, it was something my pastor was saying, if you ladies saw Satan and you were allowed to see him, you would be totally, you'd be totally enamored with him. You'd be like, wow. And you think you'd be like so impressed with him. This guy said, well, my wife wouldn't be like that with us. It was like, it's like, dude, people are just so ridiculous. It's just trying to impress upon you that, yeah, he would be impressed. Everybody would be impressed. The guys would be impressed by the beauty of Satan. He's not on a pitchfork. Doesn't have a pitchfork. He's not in a little jumpsuit like the world portrays him as being. No, and at Halloween and everything. No, he is he's a beautiful creature. He's the wisest creature to ever come from the hand of God. He's much smarter than any of us. In fact, he and his fallen angels and the elect angels have been observing human beings from the day they were created on the earth in the Garden of Eden. So he knows all about us. He's wiser than all of us, and we have no chance whatsoever of being victorious over him without God and his power. And so this is without the word of God. And so people don't realize that he has access to heaven. He accuses the brethren day and night. It says in Revelation 12, Zechariah 3 talks about Satan accusing the high priest of Israel's Joshua that we're reading about in our Haggai series. Accusing him before the throne room of God, and then the Lord steps in and intercedes for him, and he does that for us right now. Satan is an accuser of the brethren. The word Satan talks about the fact, and devil talks about the fact, that the legal terms, that he is the defense attorney for the fallen angels, and he wages cross-examination against believers. Like Job, he has access to heaven, it says in Job, and Satan and his angels were there. They're accountable to God. Satan can't do anything he wants. He has to get permission from God, and that's what he did with Job, and that's what he would have to do with anybody. And so all unbelievers are unsaved, and they're under Satan's kingdom. They're enslaved to sin and Satan, whether they realize it or not. They're deceived into thinking it's not the case. You and I used to be, but we were delivered from that bondage to Satan and sin at the moment of our justification through faith alone in Jesus Christ alone. It says in 1 John 5:19. It says in Revelation 12:9 that he deceives the whole world. That means your family and friends who don't know the word of God and don't know this stuff are being deceived. And the Satan's world system, that song I wrote, Don't Love the World, or not to love this world system, which seeks to seduce people away from worshiping the true and living God, Jesus Christ. So Satan has got all kinds of things to deceive us, and the only way we can protect ourselves is God's word. In fact, when we obey God's word, Satan flees from us. That's what Jesus demonstrated in the desert when he was one-on-one with the devil. He didn't exercise his omnipotence to defeat the devil. That would have been no problem. But what he did is he used in his human nature the word of God, and the devil fled from him. And it says, in fact, it says in James 4:7, submit to God and the devil will flee from you. Because he can't stand against the word of God, and then he will come back at a more appropriate time when we're not aware of, or we're letting our guard down. You got to understand that our greatest enemy is not the unbeliever. It's not your boss. It's not your ex-wife. It's not your ex-husband. No, it not the president of the United States. It's not the Democrat. It's not a Republican or a liberal, whatever you want, a conservative. The biggest enemy we have, the church, is Satan himself and his fallen angels. And we're going to see that all here this morning. So Satan, he's the one who's behind this situation that where Paul and Silvanus were hindered from seeing the Thessalonians again. And we'll talk about why would God permit that? And so we'll talk about that as well. I got an answer for that, a couple of reasons for that. Now we must remember, we're going to look at Satan for a lot here this morning. So we need to know, first of all, he's a created being. He was created by God. He's not omniscient. He's not omnipotent. He doesn't have any of the attributes of God because he's a creature just like you and I. Now, he wants to be like God, as we'll see in Isaiah, but he is not God. So a lot of Christians even get kind of concerned about, like, for instance, they're worried about saying their prayers out loud. I pray out loud. I mean, that's the way, because I'm alone. You know, I mean, if I find it easier to pray out loud. In fact, if I was married and had kids, I would find a room and I would talk and you would hear me, because I like to pray out loud, like talk out loud audibly. Everybody's different. So some people, I say that because some people don't want to say that because they're afraid Satan's going to hear what you have to say. I say, so what? So what did they hear what you have to say? What does that have to do? They're giving him too much more credit than he deserves. You're asking God according to his will. Why are you afraid? He doesn't want to hear that you're praying according to his will, because that's not going to be good for him. So don't give Satan, it's good to have a healthy respect for the angels and Satan, the fallen angels. In fact, you should have respect for them. We see that with Michael the archangel when they were arguing over the body of Moses, him and Satan. Michael respected the authority of Satan and said, may the Lord rebuke you. And so that shows, even though Satan is the author of evil and the most evil person in the universe and the start of the whole rebellion against God, even Michael, an elect angel, would not make a railing accusation against Satan because he respected Satan's authority. Satan is the temporary god of this world. 2 Corinthians 4:4 teaches that. So he has authority. And so God has permitted that for his own purposes. So Satan's a created being. In fact, as we saw in Colossians 1:16, Jesus Christ created angels who are moral, rational creatures like mankind, and the greatest of these moral, rational creatures was Satan. When I say moral, rational creatures, you and I and the angels, mankind and the angels, not the animal kingdom, we can make decision. We can make decisions for or against God. We have the capacity to think and make decisions. The animals don't. That I know some people like to think my dog or my cat does. No, that's not what the Bible says. Now, I'm not saying they don't have souls, but they're not moral, rational creatures like you and mankind is and the angels. Hebrews 1:14 describes angels as spirits, and demons are called unclean spirits. And many passages like Matthew 8:16 and Revelation 16:14 and Acts 19:12. Furthermore, the fact that we're told, and Ephesians 6:12, which we're going to look at this morning. We do not wrestle with flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the world rulers of this present darkness, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places, also suggests that Satan and his demons are spirit beings. You can't see them. They're invisible to the human eye unless God sees fit to let you see them. Like, for instance, in Kings, where it was with Elisha. And Elisha the prophet, I think it was in 2 Kings, Elisha prophet, the prophet, was given information by God about the king of Syria and what he was doing with his military. Well, he got that information and told the kings of Israel, and the king of Syria said, we got to get this Elijah because it's like he's right in my room. Yeah, he's right in the room because God and his angels, he sent his angels in, and they got the access to the information of the king of Syria that was top secret, and they were giving it to Elisha. So he said, Elisha's talking about what we're doing. How does he know that? He's like, so we got to go kill this Elisha. So he goes out and get him. And so Elisha and his servant were there, and then they were surrounded by the Syrian army. Well, Elisha's servant goes, oh, we're done here. And Elisha's, take it easy. And he prayed that God would open the servant's eyes to see the protection that was around him from the fallen angels. So he opened up the servant's eyes, and he saw chariots of fire all around the Syrian army, these angels, these elect angels to protect Elisha and his servant. And that, if God opened up our eyes, you'd be amazed, totally astounded and blown away by the protection that is around us. Remember, Hebrews 1:14, the elect angels are ministering spirits. They're ministering to you. And I can tell you, sometimes, many times in my past, where there's tremendous, I don't know how to explain it. You have to be experienced it. Maybe I know some of you have, with a tremendous oppression from, it's supernatural. It's like, you know that the Satan and his kingdom are all over you, and you just feel this tremendous weight of pressure. It's hard to explain. It's on your soul. And then it's lifted for no reason. He's like, wow. And a lot of times that's because the elect angels move in and remove the fallen angels. They overpower them. And so because they're stronger than they're stronger. And we studied this in Daniel, about the warfare in the angelic realm. So Satan and his demons are spirit beings. They're invisible to the eye. God could reveal them to us if he so chose. But he is, at this point, he's not doing that to any church age believer I know of. Finally, the fact that Paul describes angels as invisible also shows that they're spirit beings. Now, Satan, as I said earlier, is not omniscient like God, meaning he knows everything about us. He only knows that which he's observed and his angels have observed mankind over the centuries and us. So he's not omnipotent. He's not all-powerful like God. And he's also not omnipresent. He can't be everywhere in one place. So for instance, when Satan went to indwell Judas, okay, on the night of when he betrays Jesus, he indwelled Satan. Satan indwelt Judas. Satan was allowing himself to be localized at that one particular moment. So, and that's where he was. So he that means he wasn't in China at that time. He couldn't have access to North America, if you want. He was right there in that person, right there and dwelling them. So he can't be everywhere present. And he's not omnipresent. So he's not omnipotent, not omniscient, or omnipresent. So though they're very powerful, the angels and their spirit beings, they're not omnipotent, they're not omniscient, and they're not omnipresent. However, as the chief of his demon forces, or as the prince of the power of the air, according to Ephesians 2:2, he is a chief of a vast army of demons, fallen angels, who are so numerous as to make Satan's power and presence seem to be practically ubiquitous or everywhere at once. So he has, as we'll see in Ephesians 6:12, he has an order of battle. God, he mimics God. God has armies. He's very organized. God is. He's God of order, right? And Satan imitates him. And so he has his fallen angels arranged according to rank. And so there's a vast, we don't know the number, but it's a vast number of fallen angels, and there's a vast number more than the fallen angels of elect angels that are in God's, working for God, serving God. So therefore, because of this limitation, many references to Satan or the devil include his whole kingdom. Now, so that could be the case here where it says Satan hindered Paul and Silvanus. It could be representing Satan himself personally, which I wouldn't be surprised with regards to Paul and Silvanus because of what they were doing. Or it could mean Satan and his kingdom and his fallen angels were involved with this as well. So the person of Satan, remember, does not personally tempt each one of us to sin, for he simply cannot do that. However, he is only able to do so through his world system and demon army. So with Job, get personal attention from Satan, but that's very rare. For depends on the effectiveness of the believer and how close he is to God will determine if you get personal attention from Satan. I'm sure Paul did many times. The apostles individually got attention from Satan and were oppressed by Satan. But when people say they're getting oppressed by Satan, unless you're like some super duper believer and very faithful and strong, close to God, it's very unlikely that you're going to get personal attention from Satan. You're going to get his fallen angels involved. But Satan has a lot of his hands full with trying to control the world and run the world, you know, in the control and deceive the governments of the world. He's doing that and getting and trying to destroy Israel, devise ways to get to destroy Israel. So let's take a look at, hold your place in 1 Thessalonians. Go to Ezekiel chapter 28. In your Old Testament, Ezekiel 28. Ezekiel chapter 28. And let's look at verse 11, Ezekiel 28:11. Ezekiel 28:11. Now, while you're turning there, a couple of things. You and I as believers have three great enemies. For those of you who have been with me a while, you know what I'm talking about. Now, we have three great enemies. We have sin, the sin nature that indwells us. We have Satan, and then we have his kingdom. Now, in his appearance, when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, Job 1:6, we'll see this in a bit, and in the temptation of Christ, and the entrance into Judas, as I mentioned earlier, we surely have clear references to the person of Satan himself. But in many other passages, Satan or the devil seems to stand for Satan's kingdom. It is comforting to know that Satan is limited because the promise of Scripture is that greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world, 1 John 4:4. For all his power and hatred against God and man, Satan could do nothing against Job that God did not expressly permit or allow. Therefore, he can be resisted and he made to flee, according to James 4:7, but only by the strength of God made available to believers, as we'll read in Ephesians 6:10 through 18. So the fall of Satan is recorded in a couple of places, Ezekiel 28, 11 through 19, Isaiah 14, 12 through 14. Now, the king of Tyre is referenced in Ezekiel, And then the king of Babylon in Isaiah passage in Isaiah 14. But as you read, you'll see that he's not talking about the king of Tyre and the king of Babylon. He's talking about Satan. So this is like a double reference here. So look at Ezekiel 28:11. For the word of the Lord came to me, Ezekiel, son of man, sing a lament for the king of Tyre and say to him, this is what the sovereign Lord says. You were the sealer of perfection, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. You were in Eden, the garden of God. The king of Tyre was not. It has to be Satan. We know that because of Genesis. We know that. You, every precious stone was your covering. Now notice he notes nine of these. The ruby, topaz, and emerald. The chrysolite, onyx, and jasper. The sapphire, turquoise, and beryl. I believe those were part of his ephod as the high priest with the angels. Each of those precious stones, like the 12 on the high priest of Israel, represented a tribe. And so here, this would be the tribes of angels. And why I say, as Revelation 12 talks about one-third of the angels going with Satan, two-thirds with God in the rebellion. So your settings, he says, were in mounts were made of gold on the day that you were created, and they were prepared. Notice that he was created. Then he says, I placed you there with an anointed guardian cherub. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked about the midst of the fiery stones. You were blameless in your behavior from the day you were created until sin was discovered in you. In the abundance of your trade, you were filled with violence and you sinned. So I defiled you and banished you from the mountain of God. The guardian cherub expelled you from the midst of the stones of fire. Now, some translations like the NET Bible saying, not making Satan as the guardian cherub, but there's other translations that do as well. Now, notice that the mountain of God, that talks about the government of God. So he was expelled from the government of God. Verse 17, your heart was proud because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom on account of your splendor. I threw you down to the ground. I placed you before kings that they might see you. So like the king of Tyre was arrogant because of his wisdom or because of his beauty, so Satan was in eternity past. Look at verse 18. By the multitude of your iniquities, through the sinfulness of your trade, you desecrated your sanctuaries. So I drew fire out from within you, judgment. It consumed you, and I turned you to ashes on the earth before the eyes of all who saw you. All who know you among the peoples are shocked at you. You become terrified and will be no more. Now, go over to Isaiah, which is a couple of books before Ezekiel. Look at Isaiah 14. Look at verse 12. Isaiah 14, 12. Now, there's another double reference. You get the king of Babylon, but he's actually, you can see, talking about Satan here. Both the passages are talking about, one is talking about the king of Babylon's arrogance, but also it's, you can see it's reflecting Satan's arrogance. He's imitating what Satan did. Verse 12, look how you have fallen from the sky, O shining one, son of the dawn. You ever hear the term Lucifer? The word Lucifer is taken from a Latin term. It's a transliteration of a Latin word. We call it in English Lucifer. Well, that Latin term, which is from the Latin Vulgate in this passage, Lucifer in Latin is basically translating you, oh, shining one, son of the dawn, shining one. So Lucifer actually means shining one. It's the Latin term is basically translating the Greek, the Hebrew term here. So that's where we get the word Lucifer. But Lucifer is not a personal name of this angel. He's called Satan and Devil. Those are his titles. But that we don't know his personal name, like Michael or Gabriel. God has not seen fit to tell us his personal name. He just calls him adversary and the devil. So then he says in verse 12, look how you have fallen from the sky, O shining one, son of the dawn. You've been cut down to the ground, O conqueror of the nations. Remember, Satan was cast out of, he's going to be cast out of heaven during the midway point of the tribulation, according to Revelation chapter 12. And Jesus mentions that. He prophesies that. He says, I saw Satan fall like lightning. And that's a prophecy of what's going to happen during the tribulation period. But right now he has access to heaven. He's thrown out of his position. He was the highest of the angels in rank, but no longer because of his rebellion. as we'll see. So he says, verse 13, you said to yourself, and here's the five great I wills of Satan. I will climb up to the sky above the stars of El. That's a reference to God. I will set up my throne. I will rule on the mountain of assembly, on the remote slopes of Zaphon. I will climb up to the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. See, Satan, that's what his intent is. I want to be like God, therefore I want people to worship me. And so you and I are to worship the Father and the Son and the power of the Spirit. But the non-believer, because they don't worship the Father and the Son and the power of the Spirit, they're really at reality worship than the devil, whether they realize it or not. Because everything in this world is designed, that's in this world, the world system of Satan is designed to lead people away from worshiping Jesus Christ, the true and living God, and to worship, you know, to put more value and spend more time on relationships or money or trying to seek power. Satan will try to do anything he can to put ahead of your relationship with God and obedience to God. That's very important to understand as a Christian, because if you don't get it, you will be deceived. And Satan will get you away from obeying God and getting into his world system, which is very attractive. But it's very attractive, but it's leading men into destruction and women. So let's look at, you saw that passage. Now, I said he has access to heaven. Look at Job. Look at the book of Job, which is, you got to back up a few before Isaiah. It's before the Psalms is Job. Go to Job chapter 1. Job chapter 1. Look at verse 1. He has access to heaven. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was pure and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. 7 sons and 3 daughters were born to him. His possessions included 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 female donkeys. In addition, he had a very great household. Thus, he was the greatest of all the people in the east. Having all these sheep and camels and oxen and donkeys, that was, in fact, it signified that he was a very wealthy man in the ancient world. Verse 4, now his sons used to go and hold the feast in the house of each one in turn, and they would send and invite their 3 sisters to eat and drink with them. When the days of their feasting were finished, Job would send for them and sanctify them. He would get up early in the morning and offer burnt offerings according to the number of them all. For Job thought, perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God in their hearts. This was Job's customary practice. Now, the day came when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. Benaha Elohim, sons of God, translated in the Old Testament 6 times, it always refers to the angels. Not like sons of God in the Old New Testament is the church. No, this is the angels here. They came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also arrived among them. This means he's accountable to God. He has to give it a show up. It's what do you call it? Reveille. You know, it's like, you know, in the military, you got to get line up. Well, that's what he's got to do. He doesn't want you to know that too, by the way. I'm sure he doesn't appreciate me or any of the pastor telling you that. Verse 7, the Lord said to Satan, where have you come from? And Satan answered, so notice he's accountable to God. And Satan answered the Lord, from roving about on the earth and walking back and forth across it. That's a sign that he, in his mind, he owns it. In fact, it is his at this particular time, because Adam and Eve, they basically, when they fall, Satan usurped their authority in the garden. Okay, so now he's called the God of this world because of that. But that's only temporary. Verse 8, so the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? There's no one like him on the earth, a pure and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil. Then Satan answered the Lord, is it for nothing that Job fears God? Have you not made a hedge around him and his household and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his livestock have increased in the land. But extend your hand and strike everything he has, and he will no doubt curse you to your face. So he's basically saying, you're blessing Job. You're keeping me from getting at him and my angels. So I'm going to tell you, if you let me at him and let me do something to this guy, well, you know what? I bet you he curses you to your face. So God says, okay, I'll let you do it. Now, you say, well, why would God let that do it? Well, God's going to glorify himself. He's also going to give reward Job, and he's going to teach us something about this by doing so. And look at verse 12. So the Lord said to Satan, all right then, everything he has is in your power. Only do not extend your hand against the man himself. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. Now the day came when Job's sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And a messenger came to Job saying, the oxen were plowing and the donkeys were grazing beside them. And the Sabians swooped down and carried them all away, and they killed the servants with the sword. And I alone escaped to tell you. While this one was still speaking, you think you had a bad day? Job had a worse day. Another messenger arrived and said, the fire of God has fallen from heaven and has burned up the sheep and the servants and has consumed them. And I alone escaped to tell you. Notice that Satan and his angels can use the weather. See that? Verse 17, while this one was still speaking, another messenger arrived and said, the Chaldeans formed three bands and made a raid on the camels and carried them all away. And they killed all the servants with the sword. And I alone escaped to tell you. While this one was still speaking, another messenger arrived and said, your sons and your daughters were eating and drinking wine in their oldest brother's house. And suddenly a great wind swept across the wilderness and struck the, where do you think that wind came from? Struck the four corners of the house, and it fell on the young people, and they died. And I alone escaped to tell you. This is important to know what Satan has the ability to do, that God permitted him to do. And when we think about Paul and Silvanus being hindered from seeing the Thessalonians, and this same person is doing stuff. There are many things that probably happened in your life and my life as believers that the enemy had a part of. And you wonder why certain things haven't happened. Maybe God has allowed Satan, he's asked permission, and he's doing something with regards to you, whether it's to attack your family, your health, your job, your finances. God allows it because God's going to use that to draw you closer to him. When you're weak, you're strong. My power is manifested in your weakness. In fact, Paul said that in the context of God giving a messenger of Satan to keep him humble and giving some tremendous physical suffering to keep him humble. So a lot of things going down here. Verse 20, then Job got up and tore his robe. He shaved his head and threw himself down with his face to the ground. And he said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will return there. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. May the name of the Lord be blessed. Wow. Pretty impressive. When I get a flat tire, I don't know if I'm doing that. I'm going, I can't believe it. Got a flat tire. Titus, you're not flat for me. So it's funny. I had a flat tire and he drives up one time. It's like in my parking lot, I get a flat tire. I was like, but anyways, so here you go. What am I going to do? Our first reaction would be, trust me. We'd all be going, you'd be like, oh, Lord, I can't believe this, all that blah, and you start complaining. Did Job ever complain? No, he didn't. And that guy had lost his whole family except for his wife. And his poor wife, well, she went through it. Everybody makes fun of his wife, but his wife was like, she's lost all the kids, you know, and everything is just wiped out. Now, that passage tells you Satan has power, and his angels have power, and they can do things to attack us. So, that's very important that you understand it. But they can only do it if God permits. So look at Ephesians. I'll show you another one real quick. Go to the New Testament and go to Ephesians. You have the Gospels, the first four books. Then you have Acts. Then you have Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians. Then you have Ephesians. Look at Ephesians chapter 6. Look at verse 10. Yeah, what do I want to do? Yeah, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Yeah, here we go. So the leader of the church's great invisible enemy is, of course, Satan, whose name means adversary. That's what Satan means, because he's the enemy of God. He's compared to a lion in 1 Peter 5:8, and he's described as a serpent in Revelation 12:9 and Genesis 3:1. He's described as an angel of light in 2 Corinthians 11:13 through 15. He's called the God of this world in 2 Corinthians 4:4. The Christian is not to be ignorant of his schemes, according to 2 Corinthians 2:11, in his devices. And 1 John, as we studied a couple of years ago in our weekday classes, 1 John 2:15 through 17. 1 John is getting loads of hit, those classes. I'm really happy because I really worked really hard on that. And it was that was That's getting a lot of hits, that whole series, which is really good. Great book. Great book for new believers to learn and a mature believer. 1 John 2:15 through 17 prohibits the church age believer from loving Satan's world system, which is designed to seduce people away from God and obedience to him. Now, you might say, what is Satan's system? Well, let's stop right here. Entertainment. Let's take entertainment like sports and music. Okay, I just take it. Sports and music. They use that. There's nothing wrong with them. Is there anything wrong with sports and music? No, I love sports and I love music. Music is a gift from God. But Satan will use it in a way where he'll get human beings to make idols of our musicians and entertainers and sports and be engrossed in sports to the exclusion of who cares about God and eternity. Dying? I'm not going to die. I'm going to watch the Patriots win another Super Bowl. That's how they do it. They use even relationships. Look at your world that we live in. I'm a single person. I'm 57 years old. All you see on television or billboards, you know, is the dating thing. You know, if you don't have a relationship, there's something wrong with you, okay? it's jammed down your throat every single day. You got to have a relationship. They got even Christian mingle now. Nothing wrong with a relationship, right? God created the man and the woman to be together. But this is the problem. Satan will want you and tries to seduce you with his world system as he uses the media, does that. He's the god of this world, the prince of the power of the air. He will use the media and he will try to get you and I to put our relationships ahead of our obedience to God. Make our relationships with our husband and wife is more important than our relationship with him. No, we got to put our relationships in proper perspective. Our children, our family, our husbands, our wives, our parents, in proper perspective. Everything comes second to God. In fact, your relationships with your family members, husband, wife, parents, children, will get better as you obey God, as we've seen in the past. Look at Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10. Finally, be strengthened in the Lord and the strength of his power. Clothe yourselves with the full armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. The full armor of God is your union and identification with Christ. Okay? You're crucified, died, buried, raised, and seated with Christ. That gives you your deliverance over sin and Satan. And when you consider yourself dead to sin nature and alive to God, dead to the cosmic system and alive to God, you are going to get victory over. That's your full armor, Christ. And particularly your union identification with him is your full armor of God. He's using a military metaphor to describe that. So that you may be able to, why does he want you to do this? So that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. What is the devil's schemes? To get you to doubt his word. God's word says this, the devil and the world system say, that's not true. God's word says, you'll find in the world, that's why you see in the world, you see people in the media, whether it comes to raising kids or relationships or sex or homosexuality, the world's going to contradict the Bible. Why is that? Because Satan is the god of this world. Okay? Clothe yourselves, he says again, verse 11, clothe yourselves with the full armor of God so that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. That means human beings. But against the rulers, against the powers, against the world rulers of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavens. That's the satanic order of battle there just listed. He has ranks. He has generals. He has colonels. He has sergeants. He has buck privates. Okay? Verse 13, for this reason, take up the full armor of God so that you may be able to stand your ground on the evil day. And having done everything to stand, stand firm, therefore, by fastening the belt of truth, the word of God, against your waist, by putting on the breastplate of righteousness, your righteousness that you received through faith in Christ, the righteousness of Christ, by fitting your feet with the preparation that comes from the good news of peace, the gospel. And in all of this, by taking up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. When I see a Christian, brother or sister in Christ, and they're doubting their salvation or doubting the existence of God, I said, this person is getting bombarded with the flaming missiles of the evil one. And I pray. That's exactly what that is. They get you to doubt God. Is he going to take care of me? Where am I going to get the money for this? What am I going to get to do this? And fear is their intimidation tactics. They love fear. They do it on me. They do it on you. It doesn't matter who you are, you're a pastor. They want you to be afraid. In fact, True story. When the church split was happening over there at Prairie View, I remember talking to Titus, and he said the fear over there, the fear was people were afraid. It's like, and you could feel it. And then that's the presence of the enemy. They get everybody afraid and suspicious of each other. That Pastor Bill, or you get the pastor suspicious of somebody in the congregation. I've seen that happen. It happens. And that's what he tries to do. Satan is not down at the strip bar. He's got everybody there. He's not down with the drunks at the bar down the street. No, he's in the churches. He wants to get us. We're the ones that are following after God, and he wants to stop that. It doesn't matter if it's a tiny little house church in Marion, Iowa. He still wants to stop it. He's trying to bring it down. You say, well, you're just a little tiny church. What does he care about? Oh, the little tiny church? God doesn't need large numbers. God can take a small little group of people and spread the word of God throughout the globe. So that's just what's happening. You come into Bible class, supporting this ministry, praying for this ministry, giving to the ministry, Titus with his work, the internet, and what I'm doing. And now we're all over the world. There are people who are listening all over the globe, in every continent. I kid you not. Everywhere. Except for the Antarctica. I haven't seen anybody up there in Antarctica or the South Pole, okay? So I guess those continents are not. So there it is. And so they don't like that. You don't know who's listening. You don't know whose life is being changed right now by the Spirit of God through the teaching of the Word of God in this ministry. You just don't know. But Satan would like you to get discouraged. He wants me to get discouraged. And I can't tell you how many times he's gotten me discouraged to the point of despair. Despair. You say, how can that? It's easy. I'm a target. You're a target. And you know what? When I'm going good and I'm not, he can't bother me too much. He goes after you because he knows if I can get these guys all worked up and get them all upset and knock them away, I got him. If I can't cut the head off of the animal, I will cut his wings off. And I'll do anything I can to get to bother the people around him. And that's what he's done. He's been doing that. He does that our ministry. He's done that to other ministries. It goes on all the time. Where is target? That's why you need to pray and do what the Word of God says. Have faith in the Word of God. Obey the Word of God and pray and pray. Pray. Look at verse, he says in verse 17, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. With every prayer and petition, notice the Word of God in prayer. The Word of God, with every prayer and petition, pray at all times in the Spirit. And to this end, be alert with all the perseverance and request for all the saints. So there we have it. Go back now to 1 Thessalonians. A little bit of perusal of what Satan, his tactics, what he does, and who he is, and where he's been, where he's going. Look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. Now look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, and look at verse 18 again. So it says, for we wanted to come to you. I, Paul, in fact, tried again and again, but Satan thwarted us. Now, this first assertion in 1 Thessalonians 2:18 is designed to assure the Thessalonian Christian community that Paul and Silvanus had every intention of returning to Thessalonica to minister to them. Why do they feel? They felt the need to do this, to assure the Thessalonians, because of the slanderous attacks I've been telling you about. That were waged against them by the unregenerate Jew and Gentiles in the city of Thessalonica. Remember we saw in 1 Thessalonians, this first assertion in 1 Thessalonians 2:18, and like the ones in 1 Thessalonians 1:5 and 2:1-16 were designed to defend the conduct of Paul, Silvanus, as well as Timothy. Remember, first 16 verses of 1 Thessalonians chapter 2, 1 Thessalonians 1:5 introduces the subject to defend Paul and Silvanus in their conduct from the slanderous attacks that were being waged against them by the unbeliever in Thessalonica. So these three men, Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, were concerned that the Thessalonians would be deceived by the accusations made against them by their enemies in the city of Thessalonica. Satan was using the non-believer to try to bring down Paul in Thessalonica. He wanted the Thessalonian church to go into apostasy. And he did it. How was he going to do it? I'm going to go after their leaders, Paul and Silvanus and Timothy. I'm going to slander them. Maybe some of these people will buy into these accusations, which are not true. Boy, that sounds familiar. What do you think a lot of church splits start from? It's the devil and in the flesh of people, living in the flesh. That's what he was trying to do to Paul and Silvanus, trying to bring them, trying to discredit them in the eyes of the Thessalonians. Satan, his name, what is it? Satan, a devil means slanderer. Adversary is the word for Satan. He's a slanderer and he's an adversary. So whenever you hear slander going on among people, you know where it all came from. The enemy. It's coming from the enemy, especially when you hear slander in churches. So these individuals, as we pointed out, that were slanderously attacking Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, were composed of non-Christian Jews in the city of Thessalonica. We know that from Acts 17, 1-9. And all as well as the non-Christian Gentiles, according to 1 Thessalonians 2, 14-16. Now, I think we'll close with this. One might ask as to why God would permit Satan to hinder Paul and Silvanus in returning to them to minister to the Thessalonian Christian community. Why would God allow Satan to do this? I mean, why did he let Job get attacked by Satan? I mean, obviously God has Job's best interests in mind. He had the capacity to deal with it. God wanted to glorify himself. He has every right to do that. God is the potter, and Job is the clay. God can do anything he wants with us. You want him to do that. Now, if he allows you to be personally attacked by Satan or the fallen angels, he knows you can handle it. He will not allow you to go through anything that you can't handle. So why would God, again, and we'll close with this, why would God permit Satan to hinder Paul and Silvanus in returning to minister to the Thessalonians? Well, one answer is that if God did not permit Satan to hinder these two men when he did, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians would never have been written. And we never would have benefited throughout, the church would never have benefited throughout the centuries from these two great books. In fact, Paul's prison epistles, Paul was in prison unjustly. So Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, and Philemon, two of those books we studied in detail, they never would have been written. So God allowed that. We got these great books. What Satan meant for evil, God meant for good. Always remember that. That's a principle taught way back to Joseph. Joseph's brothers, they were jealous of him, and they sold him into slavery. They were going to kill him, but one of the brothers chalked him out of it, sold him into slavery, but then he ends up in, by the providence of God, he ends up being the prime minister of Egypt, who has all control, where there's a great famine in the earth, and Joseph's brothers have to come all the way to see him. Unbeknownst to them, he looked like an Egyptian. They didn't know it was his own brother, and his brother knew who they were. And they had to come to him, fulfillment of prophecy. And God allowed that all that suffering of Joseph so he could save his family and basically save the world with this. Because God brought in the famine. Prior to that, he brought in 7 years of prosperity. And Joseph knew what to do, save up some of this for the bad years. And he did. And so he was able to sell stuff off to other nations and give them food. And Joseph saved his family and basically Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, Joseph and his brothers, they all became from them came the Christ out of the tribe of Judah, right? So extended the line of Christ through Joseph. Now, the church has benefited from these two epistles for centuries up to the present moment in the 21st century. They never would have been written if it wasn't for Paul and Silvanus being hindered by Satan to come to see the Thessalonians. Secondly, Satan's efforts to hinder these, this is very important. Satan's efforts to hinder these two men from returning to the Thessalonians forced Paul and Silvanus to go to God in prayer, which was for the benefit of their faith. You know, when I go through adversity, you know what I keep looking back at? Every time I go through those times, I grew a lot because, man, I was praying like crazy in some of these instances, like crazy. And I was totally immersed in the Word of God. I was clinging to God because of the adversity. Because when things are going well, we get lazy. We do. That's our nature. We're sinners. Very few people can maintain the discipline needed when things are going well. You know, when you get a big raise at work, you get married, you get a kid, you get a lot of things are going good in your life. I'm like, oh, all these blessings. And so we have a tendency to drift away from God. But when crisis comes in, a tragedy comes in, a crisis comes in, God's got your attention, doesn't he? And you either, the adversity will either make you or break you. You either get bitter at God or you'll get closer to God and love him. I've seen both go with believers. I've seen it go both ways. When people, believers get bitter toward God when things go bad. But I've also seen the same, the opposite, where they, no matter what they went through, they became stronger in their faith. They drew closer to God. They love God even more, which is demonstrated by their increased obedience to God's word. So also remember this, we forget about Paul and Silvanus. God was like with us, God is concerned, was concerned about their spiritual growth like he is with ours. So God was concerned about the spiritual growth of Paul and Silvanus, as well as the Thessalonians, remember? And this would involve the testing of their faith. So by separating the Thessalonians from Paul and Silvanus, it tested the faith of both groups, Paul and Silvanus and their faith, and as well as the Thessalonians' faith. Thus, therefore, so though Satan hindered these men, it resulted in the spiritual growth of these two men, as well as the Thessalonians, who were undoubtedly praying to the Father for their safety and return to them. Thus, very important, Satan's efforts backfired on him. He went after him, went after Paul and Silvanus, went after Thessalonians. They were new believers, probably not even believers a year old. He figured he got them. But those immature believers, really, were able to defeat Satan because of the shield of faith. The shield of faith. I've seen young believers who are not even believers for 5 years go under pressure, and they walk through it magnificently. And I've seen believers who were with the Lord for a long time and have doctrine and listen to the word of God and just act like baby believers and act miserable and terrible. You can go either way. So they were, the Thessalonians, all that Satan was trying to do ended up backfiring him on him with regards to the Thessalonians and Paul and Silvanus. Well, hopefully this service was help you in understanding who you are in relation to the devil and his kingdom, and the importance of appropriating by faith our union identification with Christ, obeying God's word, praying, the word of God in prayer. Those are our invisible weapons. We need to use them against our invisible enemy so that we can become invisible heroes. What do I mean by invisible hero? God and the elect angels and the fallen angels know who you are, that you're a faithful and victorious believer, that is God is working through, and his power is being manifested in your weakness. And when you're weak, you're strong. The fallen angels and the elect angels and God knows. The world might not know you're a hero. You know, they might honor their heroes and that they can see, but the true heroes are the invisible heroes in the church, because they're the ones that are fighting for the souls of men and with God and trying to build up and edify the body of Christ to bring glory to God in his kingdom. Well, let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to study your word. We pray that this, the Holy Spirit would mightily use this lesson to help your people experience victory over Satan and his kingdom. Help us to encourage us and press upon all of us, each one of us, to be dependent upon your word and prayer, and to trust in you. And no matter what the circumstances might be, that you'll never leave us. Remind them that you'll never leave them or forsake them, that you're indwelling them, and greater is he that is in you than he who is in the world, Satan. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.